ladies and gentlemen, next item is a request from the Valdosta Historic Preservation Commission. The way this works is the appellant, which is the person that's making the appeal, gets to speak first, and then you have 15 minutes, and then the Valdosta Historic Preservation Commission will have 15 minutes for rebuttal. So at this time, whoever is making the presentation on behalf of the appellant, please come forward.
And you have 15 minutes.
Thank you for all of these here to refer to that, but thank you for here to get on this. I don't want to repeat myself from last time. I wanted to add just a couple comments about this particular property that I didn't mention last time, and that is ever since that property was transferred over to the Isaloo for the use of the Isaloo oil station, they've had problems getting in and out on Ashley Street because of its proximity to the light at the Gordon Street intersection. It stays backed up, so you can go there just about any time of the day, and you see that there's congestion on the front of that property, and it's practically impossible to get in and out of there. The current tenant that was there in January is gone because there was an inactive parking. There was another thing I left out was there was extensive fire damage inside that building many, many years ago, I think before Isaloo got there. And at that time, the building probably should have been taken down, but it wasn't. They just covered it up and never have used it. To use it for its original purpose is not economically feasible at this time. It's a warehouse. The problem with the warehouse is it's about 3 or 4 feet off the grade, and the property slopes down to Ashley Street from the back of the property to the front. So it's got a number of problems with trying to use it as a warehouse. If you want to convert it to an office building, you would just have to spend a ton of money to do it. You had to practically rebuild the building for the sake of historical preservation at 902 North Ashley Street. If you drive up North Ashley Street, can you honestly say that taking down that warehouse is going to significantly change the historical character of the neighborhood? Because that's the standard we live by. And if it doesn't significantly change the historical character of 902 Ashley Street, or that block, the 900 block, if you're familiar with that, you will understand what I'm saying. If it doesn't significantly change the historical character and detract from it, then we should be allowed to take the building down. And I'm asking the council today to vote to allow us to take that building down. Thank you.
Thank you.
property in the local historic district. A lot of research goes into that. Professionals are hired to help the city. This was done several years ago when they are actually trying to create a district. And they identify each building that is contributing. It takes a lot of time. The process is very extensive to actually create a historic district. I know the current chair of the National Historic Register in the state of Georgia, and we've seen cases that the communities spent more than 10 years in trying to actually come up with that district and to be able to properly document and research every single contributing property. So going back to the question, what makes this specific building historic and significant, or why is it considered contributing? Three elements. We look at the age, integrity, and the significance. The property has to be old enough to be considered historic. In general, it has to be at least 50 years old. In this condition, this building was built probably in the 40s. We know that the foremost dairies existed back in 1952. So the building was built before that. And let's assume it was built in the 1950s. The building is at least 65 years old. So the criteria number one is met. Number two, integrity. And the way you look at that is, you look at the building and you try to identify elements, events, architectural, significant architectural elements, everything that links that building to its historic era, whether that building is a defining, historically defining element or it represents that era. This clearly, from so many different levels, it does. Just by the fact what it actually contained, the foremost dairies, that identifies the building's history very specifically. That is a fact of its history. I can go on and on, but that's one of the elements to look at. Significance is defined in three ways. That's again similar to integrity. So it's defined by events, by money, the distinctive physical and spatial characteristics, architectural style, or by having the potential to be an information or to understand the past of our community. And I'm going to look at, sorry, for integrity, we also look at how impactful the building is still. So if you look at the building, is it still in on this operational feel, the character, the historic integrity of that building? And for each one of these criteria, it's a check. Yes, yes, yes. Otherwise, this building will not have been considered a contributing element. So this is as far as the first question. The historical significance, it is absolutely a contributing element. This is a historic building in this part of the historic district. The next item is economic feasibility. Okay. So economic feasibility is very difficult to really talk about without proper assessments. So if we want to take that route, we would like to see an actual some sort of an assessment to that regard. So for example, a reasonable economic return is determined through looking at, you know, was the owner aware of the fact that this is a historic building at the time of purchase? What is the current economic return of financial liabilities associated with that building? How many attempts have they attempted to sell or rent the building? What is going on with that? Feasibility of alternative uses. Use of available economic incentives, which we understand that that has not been looked at either. I want to highlight that reasonable economic return is not necessarily the highest and best use for a property, whether it's in the historic district specifically. So this is where I question that one criteria without adequate backup. How do we define whether this is really economically feasible or not? I have been personally involved with very many rehabilitation projects, and people specifically pursue them just because of the economic incentives available there, which we talked about that last time. So the last item mentioned here was the impact of demolition on the surrounding areas of historic
council have any questions for either party?
I have a question for staff. If this request for the appeal is not, we can have to bring the request back to you.
Our ordinance suggests that we wait 6 months before the request is reheard by the historic preservation commission. Once they have, it's not exactly set in stone, but it requires me to take 6 month break from having it reheard, unless there is a substantial change in the application. So if the application were to change, for instance, there's no longer demolition, but there's rehabilitation, but then it can come immediately back to the historic preservation commission.
My next question is, if they were to go ahead and tear this building down, what would happen? If we deny it tonight, the appeal, and then next week they tear the building down, what would happen?
I'm not exactly sure that what I would be able to tell you tonight would be the exact process that would happen. I can give you my opinion of what I understand to be the process. The first action that would happen is a city marshal would appear at the site with the stop work order and stop the demolition. Then there would be a $250 fine that would be issued to the person working without a permit. And then the city marshal would set up a court date for a municipal court hearing where the applicant would not be able to do any more at that point since the stop work issue it was issued. And then they would go whenever the municipal court date was set up. That's the best of my understanding.
So after hearing that answer, is there anything in that answer that would possibly make them want to stop or not demolish the building because they would only have to pay $250 in a fine? You say they started at 6 o'clock one night, there isn't going to be a marshal on call or in the office, and they had it demolished by the next morning. $250 isn't. It might be worth demolishing it to pay $250 to get the eyesore off the street. Does that make sense? So I find that that in itself is a problem. Because that is not that won't stop them from doing this personally. So I think the fine system's broken. I also think the system's possibly broken in that whether I or anybody else up here thinks that the property is an eyesore and possibly should be demolished. We're not here to vote on it. Well, I'm trying to get your question answer here on this.
I'm glad you got your answer.
But in your opinion, would anybody with a $250 fine or the city marshal is on the outside?
Your staff, you could help.
If they wanted to go that route, they would have done that already. I appreciate the fact that they're lawyering the system and they're using the process to come. They have done this twice now. And I hope that we will be able to reach some sort of agreement.
I'll ask the police officer to lie to the line, sees that they're going to call and check the marshal's office.
this council to make decisions and not tear that building down. But we had $250 on such a, we would stop it from tearing that building down because of the will of this council. If they refuse and they continue to tear it down, in my opinion, that would be obstruction of the whole performance. There is a charge such as you agree.
Boston, if it was stopped on the board order, and we allow issues of that, we jump into the previous report, like any file that would be typical or. Judge, what she would, well, she would make the decision, but that would be whether fines per day or incarceration.
All right, council, we have three options. We can uphold the commission's determination upon finding that the commission did not use its discretion. We can reject the commission's determination upon finding that the commission used its discretion. Or we can return the matter to the commission, which we've already done. So, hearing that, at this time, I'll entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, if you have any questions for us,
I was
feeling that this will happen. And that was confirmed when one of our council seats would be here. I've been to this building. I've been in numerous times over the years. And quite honestly, my feeling is the building has not been maintained, it has not been kept up. It's not the original historic building that it was. It's been painted. The building next door is red brick, which I think is a beautiful historic building. The door on one side of it, which has been changed, somebody put a stone around the door and installed a modern glass door. And none of these things have ever, been noticed, I guess, or I don't know whether they have or not. Anyway, one of my main things is to make sure that we change our ordinances to reflect today's situations and today's times. And because of all those reasons, I'm going to have to put a nay on the motion to uphold the commission's report. So the motion fails. I voted nay. So the motion fails. We'll refer.
Thank you, Mayor.
All right. Okay, now. Yes.
We should have 40 years of time council.
opposed to that particular motion, please raise your right hand. Three and three. And I'm voting, this time I'm voting yea in favor of rejecting the commission's determination. And I assure you, this will come up at our retreat. As you know, one of my main things has been updating our, revising our ordinances, and we will certainly, as we run into these things, we will certainly continue to do that. All right, next item, Richard.